When bad times show up in a network marketing company, many people don't stick it out. This woman persevered through some very challenging product failures and more, and it has totally paid off. Hey, hey, Wealth Warrior. I'm Jackie Ulmer, and welcome to today's show. I'm a top earning, award-winning expert helping network marketers, coaches, and mentors make money without annoying their family, friends, or strangers, and build a thriving social selling business. I've sold products and services and built teams in over 40 countries without leaving my home. If this gal can do it, with no formal training to begin with, so can you. Most people today are struggling with stare, compare, and despair when it comes to posting good, engaging content that gets eyeballs, engagement, and makes sales out on social. You probably know what I'm talking about. So I'm running a 3-day challenge in a few days, and I'll be coaching you through creating a stunning impact introduction that can be used in multiple areas, along with how to share your business story without annoying people. Stop right now and get the details, killercontentformula.com. Killercontentformula.com. You'll have access to my 9-part email series that created a $1 million business, and I'll walk you right through how to use it to create everything you need on social media. 7 years ago, I had the pleasure to interview my good friend and fellow network marketing professional, Margie Alaprande. I plan to have her back as soon as we can mesh our schedules together. With so many challenges going on, I thought it would be a great time to share the previous one from 7 years ago with you and give you some insight and encouragement. Now, this was back when we just used a conference line to record calls, so the sound is not as good as today, but the content is priceless. Listen up and enjoy.
So Margie, thank you so much for agreeing to be here. I know our listeners are going to get true value out of everything that you have to share from your rich background and experience.
Thank you, Jackie. It's always wonderful to work with you. I love doing these calls with you.
Well, I love it as well. So before we get into your background, do you have a favorite success quote to share with the listeners?
I have so many favorite quotes. One that is especially, I guess, touching or resonating with me right now is a Leonardo da Vinci quote, and it goes like this: once you have tasted flight, you will forever walk the earth with your eyes turned skyward, for there you have been, and there you will always long to return. And I think what I love about that and network marketing is that wherever we are in our business building phase or stages of achievement, very beginning, middle management, or at the top of the pay plan, we've all had those moments when we really grasp the possibilities. And I love that. I love the analogy of having tasted flight, because there you've been and there you will always long to return. When you once get a sense of the possibilities and you begin to see this business work, it is so exhilarating that it gives you a clarity and a perspective that will drive you forward and keep your eyes turned skyward.
I love that quote. It's one of my favorites, too, and a lot of my reason for loving it has to do with my background in the airline industry and loving to travel and loving to fly, but I love how you correlated that with our profession. That's amazing.
Well, that was funny.
Yeah, isn't that funny? I think I just posted that quote, actually, like in the last couple of weeks, I posted that out on Facebook, so it's pretty funny that you came up with that
really?
One. I love it.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, I like it. I like it.
Well, tell us a little bit of your background then before network marketing. Were you career-oriented? I know you're a mom. Tell us about that.
When I found network marketing, or maybe I should better state, when it found me, I was single and I had 3 children. I had been staying home with the kids and raising them and doing, for work, I was just doing some part-time acting in television commercials and industrial films and voice work and so forth that could be great and paid really well, but it was also sporadic because it involved auditioning and being selected. And sometimes there was a lot of work and sometimes you'd get the auditions and sometimes you wouldn't. But it was enabling me to stay home with the kids. And then being single and wondering how I was going to make the house payment, I started weighing my options. What do I do? Do I have to go back to teaching junior high school music, which I did not want to do? But at some point I thought that was probably the most stable, wise thing to do because it would provide me, albeit with a pretty meager, it would be a consistent income. And I grew up in Utah, so I was really familiar with the model of the business model of network marketing, and I had not been, I'd strategically, specifically given it a miss. But for some reason, you know, right time, right place, right need, right product, really, I'd signed a teaching contract. I was going to go back. I was teaching in September. And about 3 weeks before school started, I came upon this product that I was so passionate about. And I thought, oh, my gosh, if there was ever anything that I could talk to anybody anywhere about, it would be this product. And so I made a decision to cancel the teaching contract and to jump in with both feet into a business that I had no idea how to maximize or how to even do it. And I had 3 little kids and I had no money. And it's interesting that now in 26 years of building a really significant global team that I find people will use any of those 3 as an excuse. And I had all 3. Well, I don't know this business. I don't know what to do. Why don't I have any money? And I've got kids. I can't possibly. But my kids and my desire to give them a good life and to be with them, not be away from them during their growing up years, was the thing that really compelled me to make the decision. I just fell in love with the business model really fast. Like I really, once I saw it, I got it and fell in love with it. So I guess you could say, and the rest is history.
Yeah, isn't it? So how did you find it? Did a friend call? Did you see it on a billboard?
Actually, the way that it went down, somebody that I didn't even know called and left a voice message on my answering machine talking about a product. And I had just been a paid spokesperson for this very type of a product, and I loved it. I was, you know, really wrapped up in it. Even as I was doing all of the video work for this company that was going to use my material as their salesperson, I was paid. I thought, you know, if I could ever sell anything, it would probably be that. And so when this voice came over on the answering machine, like talking about this particular product, and we want to find a company that wants to take this product, I just like I grabbed it like this. I really need to have a conversation with this person. What we ended up doing was finding a company that wanted to bring this product in, and along with it came me and a handful of other people that really wanted to sell that product. But we found a company to take it, and I've been with that company now for 26 years.
So did you take massive action then? Did you, you know, do the typical make your list? How did you launch the business?
I did take massive action because I was in that situation of immediate need, like, you know, needing to make this work yesterday, but also because I was really passionate. I fully believed that this product that we were selling was going to be in every home in America, and me and my team, we were going to sell it. And, you know, we were just absolutely going to get rich. There was no question about it. So my vision was big. I saw the value in the product. I knew everyone would say yes, and I found that was right. Like, people were saying yes. I started by just having a small gathering in my home, and the first one, 4 people came, 2 people joined me. The next of that, I thought, these are good ratios, 50%, that's good. The next week, I, you know, like quadrupled my effort, invited 4 or 5 times as many people, and no one came at all. And I took myself to a movie. So just, you know, kind of stumbled my way really in the beginning because the company was small. There wasn't really anyone to mentor me. I did a trade show. Out of the trade show, met someone that would be a superstar in our profession and was wonderful to work with, and you know, just kind of started mushrooming. I spent a lot of time on the phone. We did it, built it sort of belly to belly. There were times when I would do 2 to 3 home presentations. They were business oriented, though they had a product focus. They were very much about making money and capitalizing on the timing of this product in its niche, and creating wealth and creating passive income. So while it was product driven, it was also very money opportunity focused, and people got it. It was really a product more. Well, for women, way more than men, but I had as many men selling the product as women because the opportunity was appealing to everyone. So home presentations, and yes, absolutely, I attribute so much of where I am today to the fact that I took massive action like crazy in those early days, and I'm still being paid today on work that I did 26, 25, 24 years ago because I gave it that real intense burst of energy. And I think it pays dividends to be able to do it that way. And, you know, and every time I share this massive action piece, I always have to add that, you know, a lot is said about letting your first several months, year, your first 2 years or whatever be that massive action time. But you can declare a massive action time anytime. You can have been in your business for 8 years and you hear this call or another call or something happens in your life and you just say, now is my time. Now is the time for me. And today I make the declaration, this is my time. This is day one. And then you just move into massive action and that begins your massive action story. So that can happen at any stage in your business.
That's great advice. That's such great advice. So you started off with massive action. Were you a success right off the bat? And did you just continue to have success forever? Did you have some challenges and obstacles?
Oh, that's a long question. Let me see if I can give you the cliff note version. I did have some immediate success, but because I was putting myself out there so much, it felt like I was having plenty of knocks too, because, you know, in the beginning, the ratios of yes to no is not as strong as it gets. As you grow in your confidence and you understand and you just become more compelling as you get better and believe more. And in the beginning, yeah, the ratios were fine, but they weren't like they were later on. So there, my story that in the beginning, because I didn't have any money, I was driving to California. One time I drove to Louisville and because I couldn't afford hotels, I was sleeping in my car in hotel parking lots and getting dressed in the bathrooms of gas stations and kind of doing whatever it took to make it happen. And driving across town or the country for a promised gigantic group and having it be a small group and having a handful of people put their hands up and say yes and just working with those people and driving depth and doing all of the things that were starting to become intuitive to me and teaching persistence and you know, supporting the team. And within a year, I was making more money in a month than I could have made in a year teaching school. And there were plenty of challenges in between, plenty of times I doubted myself, et cetera, et cetera. But there was enough success along the way because I had so much action going on, so much activity going on, that there was enough success to sustain me. And but then after that, certainly there were challenges. Company changed its name early on, and they required everyone to sign a new agreement. And my teams went from 20,000 to 10,000 overnight. That kind of feels, even though it's 10,000, obviously that's still a lot of people. Felt like I was starting from scratch in a lot of ways. And we were a young company, so there were times when it was 3 steps forward and 5 steps back, for sure, in those early days. But I held on to my original vision. Once I had a team, felt, you know, a lot of commitment to my team, and so I just weathered the challenges, and there you have it.
You know, there's one story that you share that I'd love to have you share again about, you know, traveling and traveling and traveling and sometimes having nobody show up and sometimes just having one person and thinking it's not going to go anywhere. But you have one person who showed up one time at a meeting who you didn't think was going to join, who went on to do huge things. Would you share that?
Yes. I even have an addendum and a PS to that story that is so rich. I think the story that you're referring to is the meeting that I was doing in New York. Is that right? And
I think so. Yeah.
The details around this is that, first of all, I was intimidated to death to be going to New York to do a meeting. Like, that felt like really big time, and I'm, you know, from Utah, so even going to a big city like that doing a business presentation felt a little bit daunting. But further still, my cab driver, now I'm making money now. I can afford to stay in hotels. I can take cabs. I can do whatever I want now. But my cab driver got lost on the way to the meeting, so I arrived about 35 minutes late to a really impatient and irritated crowd. And I gave a presentation anyhow, just, you know, so sorry for being late, and here's a little bit about the company, here's about the product, here's about our vision, where we're going, and here's about the comp plan, here's how you get paid, here's you know, how this fits with the timing and trends of today. and anyone who wants to talk to me, please reach out to me afterwards. And my main objective, I thought the meeting was a flop for sure. My main objective was to get out of there. But at the end of the meeting, a Russian gentleman came up to me and told me that he was going to take this to Russia. And at this point, it was shortly after the breakup of the Soviet states, like 91 or whatever. And I, at that point, I never got excited by people's words. I just waited until their actions and always was there to support them. But I didn't go like, woohoo, I'm going international. I just said,
You said you never went woohoo, or, you know, I'm going international.
Went,
and then
I
you kind
I
of.
I didn't go, woohoo, I'm going international. I just would pat them on the back and say, you know, yeah, let me know how I can help you. So within a matter of a couple of months, I started noticing these names on my printout, and pretty soon there were pages and pages of them. Svetlana, Igor, Irina, Valentin, the Pizarevskis, the, you know, Roman, Igor. Anyway, on and on these names went. And this is the blessing in my business where I learned that there's a sowing season and a reaping season, and they aren't in the same season. That you plant and you plant and you plant, and some days it looks like nothing's ever going to sprout, and you look at that garden and you just go, grow, grow. And then you wonder if maybe, you know, if you're a bad planter, or maybe the seeds are bad, or what's going on, what's wrong, why isn't it happening? But the truth is there's a gestation period, there's a sowing season, there's a time to plant, and they don't come in this. You can't plant today and expect that you're going to harvest tonight. But the fact is, if you plant enough seeds, there will be a harvest. And the very cool thing is you never know for sure where that's going to come from. Like this random meeting that I thought was a flop in New York. And all of a sudden, I learned later that this guy started shipping products over in suitcases. And pretty soon, there were thousands of team members over there throughout Eurasia. And I had people in Siberia and, you know, clear, very, very far east. And I had people in Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan and Ukraine and places, Tajikistan, you know, places I couldn't, Turkmenistan. I couldn't have found these places on a map prior to my network marketing experience. And at one point, before the ruble fell, you know, I don't know, 96 or 97, whenever that was, I ordered my entire downline printout because I wanted to see how it had grown in this region as a result of one meeting. And I ordered this thing, the big, you know, the printout, the big box comes to my door. I pull out this hefty printout on green and white striped paper with the accordion folded and the perforated edges, 50 names on each side. There were over 500,000 names, Jackie, 500,000 names from one freaking amazing situation. I love that about our business. And the PS to that is last year I was in Bulgaria and speaking to them, to these teams who had gathered from throughout Eurasia. And I'm looking at these sea of thousands of faces, and I'm getting ready to speak. And I just paused for a second to drink it in. And the thought crossed my mind, what if I'd quit? What if in one of those defining moments, like when my little boy ran out and was crying when he was 3 years old, you know, what if I quit? What if I had said, oh, bag it, I'm not doing this meeting tonight. I'm exhausted too. This business is not for me. I mean, like, what if? Certainly I believe destiny has its way. Those people would have found opportunity somehow, some way, without me. But The truth is I didn't quit. I kept going. And I kept going when I felt like quitting. And I picked up the phone when I didn't feel like it sometimes. And I know I pushed through obstacles that other people said, done, enough. But I felt this immense gratitude as I looked into these faces. But then the real coup de grace of all of this, a couple of nights later when we were at our gala night, and these celebrations go through the night in Eurasia. These are really big deal celebrations. Toward the end of the evening, like 1 a.m., they invited the children to the stage, Jackie, and like 250 kids from the ages of 2, 3, 4, 5, up to teens and people, kids in their 20s, even mid-20s, went to the stage. And just, you know, as far as the eye could see, either way, were all these kids. And I, seriously, I couldn't control myself. I was literally sobbing. I thought, oh my gosh, here I was building the business for 4 children because I wanted to make a difference in their life. And look at the ripple effect now. Like, it can't be stopped. There's nothing that I could do to stop what I started. And I'm just immensely, immensely grateful.
It's pretty powerful to know that you've not only made a legacy for yourself and your own children, but that you've literally done the same thing for children all around the world. That's powerful.
I know it. I know. It's a really fun, truly fun PS to that reaping sowing story.
That is a great PS, and I hadn't heard that, so I love that. Thank you for sharing
that.
Thanks,
honey. Thanks.
Well, then this next question is probably going to be easy for you, and I know it will be, but if you had to pick 3 primary skills that you feel a person needs to develop, and I always like to say develop because most of us aren't born with these skills. We do develop them, so anyone can develop them. What would those 3 skills be?
Whoa, so I think persistence is king because, and you know, right along with the consistency, because anybody can perform, act, you know, well, for a short period of time. But if you can really continue to put one foot in front of the other and persist and do it consistently, if you're willing to just stay in action and begin imperfectly and pick yourself up each time you stumble, if you'll pick yourself up one more time than you stumble, you'll be successful. And so I think persistence and consistency. I also think humility is a really important quality because you know, the things shift in our world, and so there are new things to learn all the time. Like in my mind, you're one of the greatest experts at leveraging online, and I try to learn about this, and like I don't think you can get stuck in your ways. I also think you need to stay open and learn from your team members and just have a general humility that you don't know it all, no matter how much you make, and the humility of nobody owes you anything. And so when people opt out or people say no, you don't take it personally. But when people say yes, you're grateful and you're humble about it. And I just think humility is a really, really important quality. And I think it also in that open-mindedness, open mind. And then the last thing I would say is heart, love, like it. Grow your ability to truly love and care for people. First of all, that's a joy and reward in and of itself. Second of all, when you really do that, the business thing handles itself. And it's not that you do it, like, I'm going to love people so I can get a really big business. It's that you just become a person who gives love and receives love and you communicate love and it's what you're about. I think those would probably be my 3. I probably squeezed 5 in there, though, right, Jackie? I think there are 5.
Oh, well, we can combine some of them. That's perfect. They flow together, so that's great.
Okay.
If you were going to recommend a book to others, what book would you recommend?
Well, right now, I would recommend a new book that is being called A New Generation Network Marketing Classic. And it's by Martha Finney and me. It's called The Best Works First. I mean, there are a million books I could recommend, but right now I would recommend this book because the feedback that we're getting, it's ranking like number three right now in ebooks. It was number one in sales and marketing ebooks just a couple of nights ago, number three in network marketing overall right now. It became a bestseller on January 3rd, I believe is the date. So people are loving the book, but the thing that's gratifying to me are to hear the onesie kinds of testimonials where people say, you know, I'm leave the book by my bedside and I open it in the morning or in the night, and it just invariably, that short chapter that I read gives me the inspiration to feel invincible in my business for the day. And talking to somebody this morning said, I took the book on the plane with me and I read, there was a theme in over a couple of chapters I read. She said, I read Jordan's and yours and Onyx's, and in Onyx Cole's chapter, there was a strategy and I tried it and I got a prospect. I have a, you know, somebody interested in the business as a result of reading it on the plane and implementing the strategies. So I just, we're getting so much great feedback about this book, and I think it is, as it is being coined, the new generation network marketing classic.
And what is it that makes it so special? What, to give us a little bit of what it is. You mentioned people in chapters. Say a little bit more about that.
All right. So it's 75 network marketing experts. And the topic, I think the thing that makes it so easy to consume and to elicit actionable strategies from is that it's set up so that each of these experts, as of which you are one, Jackie, each of these experts were asked, what – suppose that you're sitting across from your ideal new team member and they ask you, from your sage advice, what is the best thing you could do, what is the worst thing you could do, and what is the first thing you should do? And so because those are just such short, cut-to-the-chase snippets, and imagine, you know, I mean, the people in this book, as you know, are household name network marketers and direct sellers. And the book is just rich with their best advice. We also asked each expert to answer the question, what is it about network marketing and direct sales that after all these years and after your tremendous success, what is it that keeps your flame burning brightly, what keeps you falling in love with the profession? And so to be able to read each of their answers and then to hear their sage advice is just it's fantastic. It makes it really easy to consume, and we've got a breadth of topics. You know, one of our friends who's an icon in network marketing, when Martha and I were putting the book together, we asked him to participate, and he said, aren't you going to get a lot of redundancy? And the answer is, surprisingly, no. It's amazing how much fresh material is here, and that was the goal. When we set out to write this book, incidentally, The Best Works First is an idea that Martha used. Martha and I met a couple of years ago by the introduction of a mutual friend, and Martha has 30 years experience in studying business models. She's a business journalist. She's got 19 published books, and she had an interest in network marketing. She felt like there's a spot for a new, fresh book, and the idea would be to get a sampling of people in their 20s to their 40s, people making 5, 6, and even 7-figure kinds of incomes, and we wanted to capture the voices of some people that even began their businesses recently and are having success in this economy so that it had a really relevant, contemporary tone. And so mission accomplished. I mean, the book is just, it's got such, oh, it's just such a great book. And you get a little look into the minds and the hearts. I mean, I submit that if you can learn how millionaires think as much as you can learn what they do, you will be successful, because you can just, imitate, just model their strategies and their mindset, and this book is just rich with them.
Well, how did it come about? You and Martha met, and she had a background, you know, in studying business and that type of thing, but how did the actual book come about, and how did the two of you connect to do it?
So we were introduced by a mutual friend and very quickly just knew there was a connection there. And we began writing, here's how it happened, we began writing a book that was, the working title was The Complete Guide to Network Marketing Success. And one day as we were, you know, knee deep into this book, Martha said, you know, in my HR interviews, I sometimes conclude them by asking people, just cut to the chase, what's the best, worst, first thing that they should do? I'm like, oh, I love that idea. And it was actually my assistant, Allison, who said, ah, that should be a standalone book. So we both fell in love with that idea. We kind of put the other book aside for the time being and started writing The Best, Worst, First because we just loved the idea and we thought it was so relevant and so had so much energy to it. And everyone we talked to about it and asked to be a part of it just said, like, no one said no to being a part of the book. And everyone that we talked to about it said, oh, that's the greatest idea. And, you know, like in your case, because you were being interviewed for both of the books. And so for this book, we ask you, because you're such an expert in social media, and reaching people, developing authentic relationships in the online world so that they can transcend any barriers to that and become thriving members on your team. Like, you're the expert at that. And so we asked you specifically, what's the best, worst, first thing you can do with regard to that? And other people that have, like, a specific area of expertise, like, let me just see some of these. Oh, some people that are like international experts. What's the best, worst thing you can do around international? Some people that, blogging, like, what's the best thing you can do around, best, worst, first thing you can do around that? And so it's just got a lot of diversity in that regard. And then just the business building basics that come across. In every case, you're hearing it for the very first time because it's so fresh as it comes from these different voices. I have a lot of favorite chapters, so it's hard to start picking them out. But you mentioned before the call there are some that you like. You said you really. Why don't we talk about a couple of your favorite chapters?
Yeah, well, like I love Kimmy Everett's because she has such a great story of being a person brand new to network marketing. And, you know, really taking massive action and, you know, in almost no time, I think it was 90 days, she was, you know, basically about to launch herself full-time into network marketing. You know, I mean, she was making enough income to be able to do that, but she took it really seriously. And she was like you, a single mom, you know. So it's kind of classic to what you started with in terms of you can let the fact that you have no money, no time, and you know, a single parent and children and all that, you can either let that derail you or you can let it empower you and you can keep going, you know.
And then one of the other things, economy, right? In this economy,
yes.
This is not, she didn't do this 26 years ago. She did this right now and she did it quickly. And so, yeah, like how valuable are her words? Who else did you say you love?
I loved, oh gosh, there's so many. Dana Collins has a good one, too. Hers is great, you know. Remove the option to quit and then stop.
Yeah.
And then her worst is, you know, get rid of saying, I'll give it a try. That's the worst thing you can do. And the two just go so hand in hand because once you remove that option to quit, you're left with doing nothing but moving forward and picking yourself back up and becoming a success.
Yes. And I think, you know, one way that people use the book is they thumb through and they find their leader or they find their company owner. I mean, we've got company owners, Cody Bateman, Richard Brooks, BK Brinko are in the book. And so it's experts and high earning icons. It's, you know, people that have 40 years in the business, people that have four, people that started in their late 20s, people that started, you know, in their 50s. And so it's got a range of demographic in that regard as well. One that I think is a nice surprise comes from Teresa Romaine, who is a very good friend of mine. She's an abundance coach. And this is just to give you an idea of the kind of diversity.
So she really believes that you can be debt-free even on some very simple basic profits. Like even if you're just making $200 to $400 a month, she talks about how you can really be free, rather, you know, to use even small beginning profits to get yourself completely debt-free in a matter of years. And so she lays that out. You know, the best thing you can do is pay off your debt with your profits. The worst thing you can do is go into huge debt. The first thing you should do is open a separate bank account. I mean, so what great advice is that? And then I'm just glancing through here, you know, you might want to see what Tim Sales has to say. And Sylvia and Orion Sally, who are amazing international leaders. Big Al from Schreider, I'm just kind of, Jerry Scribner, Bill Sylvester, Sean Smith, Roman Sobolewski. I'm just kind of Jackie Ulmer thumbing through the Mark Yarnell, Leslie Zahn thumbing through the last few pages of the book. And so it's just a rich compilation of these leaders' best stuff. In a few words, they give you the best stuff. It's everything that they've learned from their experience to help you achieve the business of your dreams too. Some people are using it as study groups. They're taking one expert a week and implementing their strategies and talking about it in kind of a mastermind format. There are a lot of ways that you can use this book for your own personal inspiration and strategic development in your business.
I love that, and I love that you brought up Teresa's, and one of the reasons I love that is because there, unfortunately, sometimes, and I know you've seen this, Margie, you're going to know exactly what I'm talking about, but sometimes there is a tendency with network marketers to have a little bit of, network marketers who make it, who become successful, to have a little bit of that lottery mentality, and they go out and they overextend themselves with buying fancy cars and big new houses and living the lifestyle kind of thing, and then a small shift with their company or a change or something like that can really upset the apple cart, and there can be a lot of broke network marketers out there who look good on the outside but aren't doing so well on the inside. So having that financial education and being, you know, a good steward with the money that you do make that will really set you up for major success, I think that's so important.
I think you are right on, and having the wisdom and the prudence to get out of debt. At the end of the day, what we really preach to people is financial freedom, and you don't want to use your new found, potentially even fortunes, to make you in further indebtedness. The idea is to be financially free. And the other piece that I love about it, Jackie, is that it's so easy for someone to not enough $400 or $200. Oh, it's not enough, you know. But, you know, you realize that if you strategically use that to pay extra and get yourself debt-free, oh, my gosh, it is enough. Because in 5 years with that kind of an income, you can be completely debt-free, 5 to 7 years, completely debt-free, including your mortgage. That's freedom.
It is freedom. And you know what? It's funny that you say that, because there are two words that I have really worked hard over the years to get out of my vocabulary when I'm talking to people or doing a presentation, and that is maybe you only want to make $200 to $400 a month, or maybe just $200, because those words, just and only, they kind of diminish the
minimize
power.
It. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, they do. And once I really became aware that I was using that because I had a bigger dream and a vision, and I realized I was kind of diminishing what somebody else's vision for the right now might be, I had to really get rid of that. So I'm glad you brought that up.
Yes.
So, tell us, how did you go about selecting the people to interview? Obviously, you must have had some criteria. Tell us about that.
Well, we knew with this book that we could draw on anyone that we feel has extraordinary understanding about how this works and what this business really is at the heart of it. And so it was really important for us to have people that we believe were aligned with our fundamental values, and that we're good people, and that we're doing the business in a respectful, reputable, we're proud to know you kind of way. So that was important. And then we looked for, you know, the household name type of people, because we knew that would help be a draw for the book, and people would want to know what they had to say is the best word first. And then we also wanted the fresh voices. So we were looking for people in their 20s, their 40s. And then, people that have made a substantial income, 5, 6, or 7 figure, whether it's as a coach or a mentor, like the people that we brought in that have, say, been in the field and now they're coaching people. They're active in the business so that they're not, you know, off on some mountain retired and raking it in still or disengaged, but that they're really in it right now and that they have been able to monetize it in a 6 and 7 figure kind of way.
Let me ask you this, Margie. What did you learn in putting this book together? Because, you know, you've got 26 years in the profession. And just like you said, you know, stay humility and, you know, learn from others. So what did you learn from this process of putting it together?
I learned so much. So there are kind of new ways there are the fundamentals, but there are also new ways of doing business today. So I feel like that's an area that I learned a lot. I think one of the sweetest aspects for me was working with Martha, because when I met her, she came with a previously jaded attitude toward the profession, but she was opening her eyes to it and her heart and her mind and thinking that there probably was really something here. And so to experience it through her eyes and to hear something that I would think is pretty basic, but to hear her go, oh, you know, just, I guess it was falling in love with it all over again, through the eyes of her as a newbie. And then I learned a lot. I get hugely inspired by seeing our business through these peers of mine and, you know, so many people that have achieved a lot. I just truly honored that they agreed to participate in the book. And I have to say, too, that some of the people that are the very, very most successful people in our profession are also the most gracious and the most humble and approachable. And I think that speaks volumes about who people become when they really fully engage and they let the business work inside of them as they work the business. So it was a freaking amazing experience. I learned a lot strategically. I learned a lot about heart. And what I realized is that we really do have an incredible vehicle in our hands with network marketing and direct sales. It is a gift. And this book can unlock that gift within you so that you can be the gift giver and make a difference in so many people's lives. It contains such richness in simple and more advanced strategies, advanced leadership ideas, duplication, how to build a team that comes and stays and duplicates, and how to get your mind right so that you can keep even and, you know, not be on tumultuous seas of frustration and up and down. And I mean, it really helps you get the long-term perspective to re-engage with your vision, what's truly possible for you, what's truly possible for the people that you're going to bring into this wonderful business. I mean, I just think it's a mainstay in our profession now.
I think you're right, and, you know, I'm certainly humbled and appreciative to be included in the book, but I know for me, I've learned a lot from it, too, and I think it's a book that's perfect for anyone, whether just starting,
yeah,
or, like you say, people doing book studies with their group, and I think it's also great. I mean, I'm a believer that there's a lesson in every single day and how we start our day and launch our day and the beliefs that run through our mind. So even if it's nothing more than picking it up every day at the start of your day and just literally, you know, close your eyes and open it and see what chapter you fall on and read it with the intention that there's something of value there for you for that day, for moving forward. And, you know, take something from that, either to inspire you, maybe, you know, and I think what will happen is you'll find if maybe you're having a downtime, it'll be something that uplifts you. If you're looking for the answer and how to approach a situation in your business, it'll provide that answer. And it may give you some wisdom to pass on to someone on your team as well.
God, so good. You summed it up so beautifully. One good idea, right? If you get one good implementable strategy and you start into your day with that and you start seeing success, that changes everything. The ripple effect is just really extraordinary.
Well, Margie, how do we find more about this book? Where do we find it?
So it is available on Amazon. It's available as an ebook now. It's also available in hardcover, which I think you should have both. I really like the idea of being able to hold a book in your hand, but I also like one that's light and transportable as easily as your tablet or an e-reader of some sort. And it's available on Amazon and Barnes & Noble. If Amazon says it's out of stock, just ignore that because it can be in stock tomorrow and they will ship almost always within just a handful of days. Even if it says that it's out of stock. And by going ahead and ordering it anyway, it kind of sends the message of, you better get this book in stock. So, after this last weekend and the weeks that preceded, I think that the sales around the book are going to send a message to Amazon and others that this book is a big deal and it's here to stay and we better make sure we keep it in, even if it's flying off the shelves.
I love that. And the in the show notes for those listeners, I'll have the link to that so that you can get right into that and get it ordered. Well, Margie, I know you've got a busy schedule, and I don't want to keep you any longer because I know you've got a lot on your plate, but I so appreciate you taking the time to be here. Do you have any parting thoughts or strategies for the listeners?
I think if I would close with anything, it would be just do it. It's so easy to build up a mound of fear between you and a simple action. And if you boil this business down to what it really is, it's you talking to people and it's you from your heart sharing something that you think is valuable without attachment, without an agenda, just simply because, yes, you would love to have them as a part of your team, but it's coming from a caring place because you have something of value. And so don't let it get built up to a point that it's such a big deal to just talk to people. That's what the business is about, talking and sharing. And so just start doing it and, just put one foot in front of the other, set yourself a goal of how many people you're going to talk to every day and do it. And in no time at all, you'll have a life that will be unrecognizable to how it is today.
Well, beautiful thoughts from a beautiful lady. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. I adore you, Jackie. Thanks for having me on, and thanks for helping to get the word out about this book. And thank you for being one of our amazing experts.
My pleasure.
So many great nuggets in that interview. I never grow tired of listening to it. It's one of those that you can get out and listen to whenever you're feeling discouraged and it picks you back up. Imagine if she would have quit. Imagine standing there in Russia looking out over that crowd and all those children and knowing that you played such a big role in changing their lives forever, changing the destiny of families and the legacy and all of that. So I hope you've enjoyed it for sure. If you have any questions or comments, let me know. Margie's such an amazing lady, and I always love the time that I get to spend with her, and it's been way too long. But hey, if you like what you're learning here on the podcast, I would love to chat with you a little bit more about the Street Smart Wealth Academy. We take all of this great content and we package it into a system and content and a true business action plan that's going to work for you. You can learn more at StreetSmartWealthAcademy.com. And don't forget to join me over on Facebook in the challenge. Just go to KillerContentFormula.com. I'll see you on the inside. And remember this, until next time, hesitation never cashed a check. Good luck to you in your business. If you would like even more tips and training, I have a free gift for you over at streetsmartwealth.me. It's my guide, Unleash the Power of Social Selling. If you're ready to stop struggling in your business and develop a sales and social media strategy to attract your ideal clients, team partners, and create the success you dream about, grab the guide right now over at streetsmartwealth.me. You'll find more on my blog at streetsmartwealth.com, as well as my Facebook group, streetsmartwealthschool.com, and follow me on Instagram at Jackie Ulmer. And make sure you learn more about the Street Smart Wealth Academy over at streetsmartwealthacademy.com. I'll see you on the next show.